We are going to continue in the series with Jabez, the heart of a champion. And so this one's going to be Keep Me From Evil. So I'd like to go ahead and read 1 Chronicles 4, 9 through 10 together. Okay. So, and Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. His mother named him Jabez, saying, I gave birth to him in pain. Jabez cried out to the God of Israel, O God, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Get me, your hand be with me and keep me from harm so that I may be free from pain. And God granted his request. So some of my favorite movies are ones that depict ancient times, like Braveheart, where it's England versus Scotland, or the medieval times, where the knights in shining armor are fighting for their king and country. Also, a great Roman thriller with gladiators battling. In those, the good guy usually wins. But what if things happen this way? The gladiator is standing in the arena, victorious. The crowd is cheering, and everything is going well for our new champion. And then round two is about to begin. The gladiator turns as he hears the gates opening. And in comes a lion, stealthily moving towards his prey. The gladiator drops his sword and starts to run. The lion pounces, and the screen blacks out. And it says, sometimes you can afford to come in second place. Sometimes you can't. So thinking about that statement, keep me from harm so that I may be free from pain. I bet that gladiator would have been praying something similar to that. Or along the lines of, Lord Jesus, help me! Jabez had a great strategy for life. He didn't ask for help through the troubles. He wanted to stay out of the arena altogether. Keep me from harm so that I will be free from pain. But as you know, pain is a part of our lives. And there are many lessons that can be learned from it. And sometimes we have to learn those lessons again and again. We go around and around in a vicious cycle. We hurt ourselves. Others hurt us. We hurt others. Around and around we go. I'm tired of being on the merry-go-round of pain. I'm ready to get off. Are you? There's this wonderful quote from a character named Mrs. Williams in the movie War Room. And she reads, I find myself amazed that the many battles we engage in today, being it money, control, or matters of the heart, very few of us know how to fight the right way or understand who we're really fighting against. To win any battle, you've got to have a right strategy and resources, because victories don't come by accident. Victories don't come by accident. We were redeemed and commissioned for the front lines. You need resources, and you need a strategy, a prayer strategy. So what does your strategy look like for dealing with pain? Mine, it hasn't been so good. Jabez had a great request. He says, keep pain from me. Keep me from harm. And so we can break that kind of down into three areas of our life. First, if you want to pull out your outlines, fill in the first blank. It's keep me from harm. So I read a story recently about a man who had overheard a conversation in a seminary between a fellow student and his mentor, Professor Howard Hendricks. And the student was so excited to tell Dr. Hendricks how well his life was going. When I first came here, he said, I was so tempted and tested, I could barely keep my head above water. But now, praise God, my life at the seminary has smoothed out. I'm not being hardly tempted at all. But Hendricks looked deeply alarmed, not the reaction the student was expecting. That's about the worst thing I could have heard, he told the surprised senior. That shows me that you're no longer in the battle. Satan isn't worried about you anymore. Are you on fire for the Lord? Or a little on the cool side? Think about it. Are you fighting a battle? Are you being tempted? If the answer is no, then Satan isn't worried about you anymore. Jesus was battled constantly by the evil one. He was tempted for 40 days in the wilderness where he was vulnerable. So he knows temptation and he knows pain. And he had a great strategy to win the battle. And he gave us that battle plan too. It's prayer. So Matthew 6:13, read it with me. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Lord, lead us not into temptation. But temptation is everywhere. Think of it kind of like this. Satan's sitting there holding a treat in front of you, telling you it'll just be our little secret. Nobody will know that you splurged on your diet. Nobody will know that you accidentally clicked on that porn site. Nobody will know you had one too many drinks the night before. And you would do anything to get that treat. You would sit, beg, roll over, and he has a whole big bag of temptations for us. And when we're pressing into the Lord, we are taking new territory. When we have a spiritual breakthrough, we are knocking down walls. We are invading the enemy's land, and he doesn't like it. And he will use whatever dirty little tricks he has to break through our battle lines. And he is a dirty fighter. He will use things like our past, our family and friends, our church family, and our pride, just to name a few. In John 10:10, it reads, read it with me. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Satan wants to steal from you. He will take everything you have. He will destroy relationships. Just look around at the church leaders who have fallen into sin. They've dropped out of ministry and left in their wake untold number of lives that are shaken, disillusioned, and injured. And Satan attacks when we're vulnerable. I know he's tried to use people in my life to distract me from my pursuit of Jesus. Just a couple weeks ago, Russ and I were at a worship night up in Vancouver at Faith Foursquare. And in the midst of some pretty powerful worship and soaking in the Holy Spirit, the phone rings. It was one of our children asking for a ride home at that moment. And we informed him that we were unavailable too because we were up in Vancouver. And the kid kind of threw a fit because we weren't dropping everything we were doing to go from Vancouver back to Portland to give them a ride home when it was like maybe a mile walk home. You know, and that discouraged us for a bit. And he was distracted. Satan had robbed him of some of the joy that he had had in the presence of the Lord. And we decided that Satan wasn't going to win that battle. Most Christians simply pray for help through the pain, to endure the temptation, for victory over the attacks of the enemy. But we don't think to ask God to just keep it away from us and keep the devil at bay in our lives. So you have a choice. Are you going to pray through the pain or ask that it be kept from you? Secondly, our pain causes others' pain. Think about a wounded animal. And it's going to lash out at anybody that comes to try to help it. The animal doesn't know that someone's there to help. All they know is they're in pain, and they want the pain to stop. People are like that too. We'll lash out at those around us, those that are coming to our aid. And in doing so, we cause pain. We say things that are hurtful, and we may even physically hurt someone. In Proverbs 23:29, we read, "Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who has complaints? Who has needless bruises? Who has bloodshot eyes?" Who has suffered here? Who has been dealing with pain? I know I have. All this last week. And it would rotate in my body. It would start in my left ankle, and it was my left ankle and knee. And then it was my right knee, my wrist, my shoulders. The pain, I've been in pain all week. So I totally understand. But who's been in emotional pain? You know, had a relationship, raise your hands up high. Don't be ashamed of it. We're all there. In fact, everybody's hands should be raised. If you're not, you're causing pain to yourself because you're denying it. But that verse kind of makes me think of people who are really suffering, and they think no one knows their pain. No one knows their suffering. And yet, we're willing to inflict some of that pain onto those around us. And it doesn't even have to be intentional. Sometimes a thoughtless remark can cause pain. At work a couple weeks ago, I was dealing with the last call of my shift, and the person I was trying to assist started cursing at me just after my greeting. I listened for another moment or two. I apologized to the gentleman for whatever was going wrong, let him know I was there to help, and that I would appreciate it if he didn't use that kind of language with me anymore. That simple statement was like adding fuel to the fire. He started blaming me for all of the things that had gone wrong with his device, that was going on with his network, why his life was going the way it was. I had ruined his life by saying that statement. My supervisor happened to overhear my request for the language to cease, and so he came over and took over the call for me. And as I stood there waiting to see how that call was going to play out, I started to tear up. That man hurt me. His words had hurt me. I was simply being kind and offering my assistance, and yet I got a firestorm of blame. I don't know the end result of the call because my shift has ended and my supervisor told me to go home, but that guy was obviously in pain and he lashed out. I don't know him. I will most likely never speak to him again. But how often do you do this? Speak before thinking about how your words will be received? I know I do it far more than I should. In Genesis 37:35, we read, "All his sons and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. No, he said, I will continue to mourn." Jacob had been wounded by his sons when they sold Joseph to be a slave and told their father that he was dead. Jacob refused to be comforted. He kept his hurt to himself. But you don't have to be like Jacob. Give your hurts to the Lord. He is our source of comfort and strength and healing. Stop wallowing in the pit of despair and stop trying to pull others into it too. Ask for help from the Lord and he will be there. In 2 Corinthians 1:4, we read, "Who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comforter ourselves receive from God?" God comforts us so that we can comfort others, not cause pain. God does not want us weighed down by our sin, our pain, or our despair. He has come to set us free so that we can help others be free as well. And the third point is this: it's time to be free from pain. Who wants to be free from pain? I know I do. So what is your strategy for being free from pain? How's that working for you? I know my previous strategy had not worked so well in the past. So you can do things like pray like Jabez. "Lord, keep me from harm so that I may be free from pain." Or like Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer, "Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from the evil one." In Psalms 5:2, we read it with me. "Hear my cry for help." I don't hear anybody reading with me. I guess I shouldn't laugh. Oops. I guess I won't laugh anymore. All right, let's try that again. So Psalms 5:2. "Hear my cry for help, my King, my God, for to you I pray." In 1 Thessalonians 5:17, "Pray continually." We're going to play a clip from the movie War Room here. And if you are not aware of that movie, it's a great one. I recommend that you rent it. It's at Redbox. But in this movie, the lead character has kind of been in a battle with her husband, and her family's kind of fallen apart. And she gets this mentor who really kind of helps her see things in a new light. And so we're going to go ahead and play that clip.
God, I need you. I know I haven't prayed like I should. I know that I haven't followed you like I should. But I need you right now. Lord, I've been so angry at Tony. And I am still so angry at him. But I don't want to lose my marriage. Lord, forgive me. Forgive me. I'm not as judge you are. But I'm asking you, please, please don't let him do this. Take over. Please take over. Take my heart and take all this anger. Help him love me again. And help me love him. He's doing something wrong. Don't let him get away with it. Stand in his way. I'm asking you, please, to help me. To steal, to kill, and destroy. But I've come that you may have life and have it abundantly. But the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. Submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. Submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. Submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. You are, devil, but I know you can hear me. You have played with my mind and had your way long enough. No more. You are done. Jesus is the Lord of this house. And that means there's no place for you here anymore. So take your lies, your schemes, and your accusations and get out in Jesus' name. You can't have my daughter, and you sure can't have my man. This house.
house is under new management, and that means you are out.
Oh, well, he cut that off just a little bit early, but that's okay.
Joy, but that's changing too. My joy doesn't come from my friends. It doesn't come from my job. It doesn't even come from my husband. My joy is found in Jesus. And just in case you forgot, he has already defeated you. So go back to hell where you belong and leave my family alone.
Awesome, huh? I did this week. Actually, I did it last weekend. I walked through my house and I did something similar. And let me tell you, I felt so good afterwards. And the devil did not like it one bit. So he has been after me all week long. But you know what? We read in 2 Thessalonians 3:3, but the Lord is faithful and he will strengthen you and protect you from the evil one. And then in James 4, she also read, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. So pray for yourself. Pray for your spouse or your significant other. Pray for your marriage. Pray for your children. Pray for our leaders. Pray for your family and friends. Pray for those who God brings to your mind. Pray continually. Pray with intention, because prayer changes things. When God is fighting for you, evil doesn't stand a chance. And prayer is the best strategy against all schemes of Satan. It attacks his flanks and makes him retreat. He will regroup and fight back, so be ready. Because the more you pray and you take things back, the more he's going to try to reclaim. And they can be simple prayers like Jesus in the Lord's Prayer. Lord, keep me from temptation. Or like Jabez, keep me from harm so that I'm free from pain. Lord, keep me from making the same mistakes that I'm prone to when temptation comes. I confess that what I think is necessary, smart, or personally beneficial is so often only the beautiful wrappings of sin. So please keep evil far from me. I'm armed and ready for battle, and I'm ready to take back what belongs to me through the blood of Jesus Christ. Who will be my battle buddy? Amen. Okay, so there is one more small clip here from War Room, and I want to show you guys kind of how prayer changes things.
Tony, you gotta take these back.
That's not it.
Liz, I could be prosecuted for this.
That's not the one. Sorry, he fast-forwarded a little too far. 1 hour, 14 minutes. Okay. No, it's not. Mine clearly says start at 1 hour, 14 minutes. And 23 seconds. There we go. That's the one.
I picked up a couple more houses to sell this morning. Asked Mandy to give me everything she could for the next couple months.
That's good, Liz. Can we talk?
Sure.
I just don't understand why you treat me this way. I mean, when I told you what happened with my job, I expected you to hit the ceiling there. So in my mind, I was ready to defend myself. Except this time I can't. hate saying this. But I deserve to get fired. I was deceiving them. And I was deceiving you. I almost cheated on you, Liz. Thought about it. I almost did it. But you know all this. And you're still here. Then I see your closet. And the way you're praying for me. Why would you do that? When you see the type of man I've become.
Because I'm not done with us. I will fight for our marriage. But I've learned that my contentment can't come from you. Tony, I love you. But I am his before I'm yours. And because I love Jesus, I'm staying right here.
I'm sorry, Liz. I ask God to forgive me. But I need you to forgive me. I don't want you to quit on me, Liz.
I will. I forgive you. I forgive you.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Lord.
And this just happened now. He did. Well, what'd he say? Oh, sweet Jesus. Oh, Lord. Oh, see, I told you, Elizabeth. I told you that God would fight for you. Oh, Jesus. All right, baby, I'll talk to you soon. Oh, devil. You just got your butt kicked. My God is faithful, and my God is powerful, and my God is in charge. You can't fire him, and he'll never retire. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. My God is good. My God is good, and he's faithful.
I love Mrs. Williams. She cracks me up through that whole movie. But you can see how prayer is a powerful weapon. At the beginning of that movie, Tony was not a nice guy at all. And yet, Elizabeth prayed for him, enlisted God to be her battle buddy, and evil had no chance. Sometimes you can afford to come in second place, sometimes you can't. And I'm tired of coming in second place to a battle that's already been won. Yeah. Satan, this is your notice. We are at war. No more playing nice. We're bringing the heavy artillery, and we are not backing down. Lord, keep us from harm so that we will be free from pain.